Good afternoon. This is Mark Richardson with Vibrant Technology, and I welcome you all to another MEscope ODS videos webinar. And today we are going to be taking another look at a top 10 list of ODS videos and taking a little deeper dive into each one of the case studies. And again, I'm joined by Dan Ambre from Full Spectrum Diagnostics, and we will get into the webinar here in just a moment. Before that, a couple of things just to remind you, everybody will be on mute for the entirety of the webinar. We are recording this webinar, so at the end you will get a link so you can go back and review anything you may have missed.
Hey Mark, your volume dropped off.
Uh-oh.
Maybe you're just not speaking into the microphone directly.
Let me see here what we got going on. I don't know what happened there.
Well, it sounds better now.
Does it?
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you. You probably turned it down.
Maybe I can turn my microphone up a little bit here. Incidentally, if you have questions, feel free to type your questions into the questions box in the GoToWebinar panel there on the right-hand side of your screen, and we'll get your questions answered at the tail end of the webinar. With that, let me hand things over to Dan, and we'll get started.
All right. Good afternoon, everybody. This is Dan Ambre from Full Spectrum Diagnostics, and we got another episode of the MEscope ODS videos, and part of this is vibration analysis. So my typical spin on these webinars is this little paragraph here that MEscope ODS videos are high-speed video vibration analysis. A clip is processed with the optical flow algorithm, enhances subtle displacements, and rescales the amplitudes. So now the processing allows the user to see what you can't see with the human eye in a video animation, either because the event is too fast or the displacements are too small, or both. This twist on it this time, and we kind of build this as a top 10 list, is a little deeper into what we're processing. So what I've tried to show is some of the images and so forth, but also you have to recognize that with the MEscope software, it allows you to do the vibration video. It also allows you to do operating deflection shape. It also allows you to do experimental modal analysis. So you can do a lot of things. There are higher levels of the software designed around the modal analysis, and you can curve fit and things like that. Regardless, if you have the ODS software package with the signal processing, you can do a modal test. You just can't do the curve fitting. You can animate the modal results, and you know the curve fitting gets you all those special details about the natural frequency and the damping and so forth that allows you to redesign the structure or reverse engineer things so that you can solve problems. But we're going to try to show a little bit of that, because the signal processing package in the software is fantastic, and there's a lot of variations, a little nuances to it that we'll try to get into. This first one I really like. This is top 10, number 10. It's a belt-driven pump system, and it's nice because it's been such a problem. There's a power plant near me that has two units operating, and they each have 12 of these pumps. And over the past few years, we've been trying to redesign the platform structure a little bit at a time. So every 6 months or so, we do a couple of them and get this stiffened up and make it run better. Otherwise, it's a flimsy structure. The nice thing about it being a flimsy structure, it makes a really good video. And there's a lot of interesting things to it that we're going to talk about in a minute that allow us to see the motions in different ways. So I'm going to actually walk through the software, the wizard, with this number 10, and then we don't have to do that again. We can just walk through the kind of case histories of the balance, the other nine top 10 videos. But this one lends itself really well to kind of a summary of the wizard. So we're gonna do that first. Oops. All right. I can't change the page, Mark. I think.
Let's see here. We you should be.
We had this last time.
Did we? Okay.
Yeah, maybe. Okay. I think I need to get out. I'm locked in here. Yeah, my keyboard isn't working right. Screen is paused. Oh, maybe that's it.
Nope. Not seeing anything yet.
My screen's locked.
Uh-oh. You want to hop out and hop back in, see if that works?
Maybe. Oh, there we go.
There you go. Now we're seeing it.
Some reason when I go full screen before you start the start the presentation, it gets a little funky. Anyway, sorry folks, professionals at work. This is all the behind the scenes stuff that you don't see. Usually we resolve it by this point, but sorry about that. This is the wizard. So when you start the software and you actuate a new ODS video, it comes up with a blank frame that allows you to do the pre-processing and set up the video for doing all its magic tricks, and we're going to walk through that. So the first one is open the raw video, and we come into this screen and we can find that video. So it'll go through all your MP4 videos that you generated with your camera or whatever your camera format is. And this one was the spray pump that we just talked about. It comes in, as you notice, dark and in the wrong direction. So when I took this image, I wanted to have a little more better use of the resolution. So I turned the camera on its side to get this shot. So this is the end view of the motor. This is that platform that it's sitting on, this little L thing that's sticking out of there. The blue part here is the pump. So it comes in whatever orientation you took it in, and we have a rotation feature in the software wizard that allows us to turn that, and we're going to do that in a moment. Okay, this screen has a lot of things. There's you can make a quick video, and it does a very high, fast resolution, low resolution, but it gets your data, you know, within seconds if you want to do that. It has a minimize flicker button down here, which tries to take into account the LED lighting and the flash rate in the LEDs. If you don't have good lighting systems, you will get a strobe effect in your LEDs. So if you buy your lights at Home Depot, that's a big mistake. And I made that the first week I got my camera, went out and bought some better, nicer lights. So the dimmable, flicker-free LEDs are what you're looking for. So we have that minimize feature. We can check that off. I leave it checked all the time. There's the rotation feature, which turns the image however you need to orient it. There's brightness and contrast, and there's also a crop tool that we'll look at in a second here. Okay, so first things first, let's brighten up that picture. Oops, I guess this is my summary. So flicker, rotation, brightness and contrast, and cropping tools are the things we're going to focus on here. First of all, I change my contrast, and usually the brightness is good enough. It's just the contrast that's a little lacking. So I always max that out, and I get a nice color image. And color's nice. Some of the competitor softwares only have monochrome or black and white. MEscope's version of the software can take anything. So any camera input you can bring in there. We have a favorite camera that's produced by Cron Technologies in Canada, but we can use any stream coming in. The brightness feature shows you the true color image and makes everything a little nicer. The rotation feature turns it on its side. So you can see I just inset a picture of the overall view of this thing. We're looking from at the end of the motor as much of it as I can see in that direction. So there's this ledge that I'm going to see deform in a few minutes, a couple of minutes. But this is the correct orientation since I turned the camera. So for the viewer, that's the best look at it. This is the cropping tool. So like any cropping tool, you draw a box where you want it. It will not change the resolution to be re-resolution inside this box. So you will lose a little bit of the outside resolution, which is okay. Some of that is not stuff that you're really interested in, especially this dark area behind here. If I can get rid of as much of that as possible, I'm losing no data, no practical data from the image coming in. There are several things in the frames and duration part of the wizard. Step number two, capture frame rate. That's important. You have to know how many frames per second the camera was set up for, so we know how to gauge the motion in the video. There's a little slider tool that tells you how much data you actually want to use. One of my previous seminars, we talked about, well, how much do you really need? And a lot of it is due to the speed of the equipment. If you have very low speed images, like a wind turbine, 14 RPM type thing that we'll talk about in a minute here, you're going to need to take the full 8 second buffer. So this little slider bar over here allows you to choose how much data you want from the buffer that is collected in the camera. So the maximum buffer there, 8 seconds. I decided to take 2. So I put my slider a little from the edge and I move this one out until I see elapsed time, 2 seconds, and I will get plenty of information. I can do more if I wish, but that's usually adequate for a normal speed operation. And this was 1800 RPM motor and I think a 712 RPM pump shaft. So 2 seconds of data. We have to have some way of scaling the image so that we can put our measurements on it correctly. The scaling tool is a set distance command. It allows you to draw a line on your system. I could do it in any direction I want, but typically vertically or horizontally is the easiest thing to do. This foot is 3/4 inch thick on the motor, and so I have 0.75 inches in my inner distance tool, and I click next, and now it's scaled the image to what the video is seeing for how far away the camera is. This is the grid point. So MEscope version of this software is completely different from what a lot of the competitors do. We can process the 1.3 million, if you look at the 1024 by 1280, that's about 1.3 million pixels. We can process them all. You don't really need to. So we do something a little bit different. We do go through all the images, all the 1,057 frames per second, all the pixels, but we assign those motions to a grid instead of using them on their own. And we can adjust the number of points or the grid coarseness or fineness with this tool and slide it along. So most of them are, 1,044 here. That's pretty coarse. We can go up to tens of thousands, so maybe 20,000 points, and the whole screen looks red. You're not getting down to the pixel level, but you're getting down to what you can functionally see with your eyes. And we're assigning all the closest pixels to each one of these dots for the animation. Okay, simplifies things. You can always use as much resolution as you like and as many grid points, but this really works out well, and it's a nice quick presentation. Okay, so I can do that slider bar. I can move it, and in this case I moved it from 1044 to 4630. That means it's taking 4,630 sets of data in the X and Y direction. Okay, so there is a lot of data. It's amazing how much comes out of this. We're going to extract the time waveforms. And the next thing that comes up is a filter displacement tool. And what this does is it tries to get rid of the large number of small displacements or background noise, which if you remember a moment ago, we talked about this dark area on the side here from the original image. It's background information that really doesn't matter. I'm looking at the structure and whatever I'm trying to paint the picture here of the end of the motor and the platform. So we can adjust out some of these measurements that don't matter in the background. We can also go from the other side where we have a small number of large displacements. Like I've had a light swinging in the background that's really a big change in motion. Shiny spots on rotating shafts, swinging chains that might have some pump information or something blowing, you know, in the image. We can get rid of that with snugging up some of this this end of this histogram that's generated. Okay, and we use these slider bars. If I slide the lower side, the large number of small displacements or background noise, I start getting rid of grid points in these dark areas that the little algorithm in the computer decides what's real background noise that might be helpful and what isn't. I can also do the other side. So this tends to take away reflections and shiny spots and things that aren't really relevant to the motion of the overall structure, but they're kind of nuisance types things. And once you do it, you don't have to stop there. I typically will keep the sliders in full range, take my first or process my first image that way. And if I see something I don't like in the background, I can crop it out basically from using this tool. So it's a helpful tool. It gets rid of some of the nuisance noise in the image. This is point graphics. And this is after we've used our histogram and pulled the points out. All the blue dots here are the points on the screen and the resolution. I like to get enough points that I can do something like what I'm about to do. See all these points running along here and then along there? They're exactly on the edge of this platform, which is, I don't know, maybe a quarter of an inch thick plate. But I have enough points in there that I can define that plate and I can put my my points on it, my grid point graphics. So what are the grid point graphics? They're labels I can generate. There's magnitude and phase information at any point I select on here. I can do a vector animation and I can do an orbit animation. And everything's real easy to do. And if I don't like it, I can hit the back button and get out of it and start over. So there is no downside to that. It doesn't, you can't get lost in all the different things you try. You can always go back to the beginning and start over. These are the points I selected. So it's a kind of a interesting little graphic here, but we're lighting up the points associated with that. So what I'm trying to do is I took 5 points and I'm trying to hit where it's connected to the motor foot, you know, and where the spans are and how it behaves vibrating around this corner. And hard to explain, easy to view. So we'll take a look at that. This is set up as a vector plot. So those 5 locations are now moving. I'm operating this at motor speed at 1768 RPM, and the platform is flexing at that frequency. So it just enhances your motion, and you can see with a quick look that everything's in phase. Everything's moving. There may be a different direction and amplitude, but all these motions are moving in phase, which indicates to me that you have some kind of twist in the motor itself. If I took another measurement up here, that vector is going to go more directly horizontal than it is up and down. Okay. If we go back here and select the orbits plot, so we've reprocessed the data, we click orbits, we don't have to get new points, we'll use the same ones, and click finish and, click finish and we're back to the image. And it's rotating, and you can see how much on the orbit plot, how much vertical versus horizontal motion that you have. Most of the horizontal motion or vertical motion on this horizontal part of the plate is pretty vertical. There's not much side-to-side motion. Over here, you have a little bit of both. So you have some horizontal motion and some vertical motion. You get more of a circle with your orbit plot. It's a simple tool, but it gives you insights. Everybody's brain works a little bit differently, and they perceive data a little bit differently. If I took some of this off, it's hard to get a grasp on it. Once I see it in this view, now I can turn the orbits off and I can see what it's trying to tell me, how it's deforming. Okay. There's also mag and phase, so we can use the same things again. We're just going to reprocess the data. We hit finish and it's animating, and you can freeze the animation if you like, but it's showing you the X and Y maximum displacements at those locations. So we can say how many thousandths of an inch or what have you. You can also scale this in the software. There's a tool to differentiate the displacement data. So you can go from displacement to velocity to acceleration if you wish. Okay. Now, the big meat and potatoes is, what am I interested in looking at? And typically we'll have a spectrum. And there's an envelope spectrum that comes with all the data. You can walk through the time waveforms. You can walk through the FFTs or the fast Fourier transform data. And we can pick out peaks that we're interested in. So here there's 479, 719, 899, and 1768. So we've already looked at 1768. That's the motor turning speed. 719 is the pump turning speed. And that pump speed is also affecting the platform. We have a 479 and an 899 CPM. These are natural frequencies of the structure. So the overall motion, kind of horizontally, a little bit of a drift down. So kind of an angled response here, and the same thing, but going a little bit up. So there's lots of rigid body modes that you can pull out of the data. There's filtering commands where we can pull out any frequency of interest that we want and just show that frequency. A lot of my data that I take, I use the time waveforms and I filter the time waveforms to a particular frequency I'm interested in. And it seems like you get the most of your image. It's a very rich looking image. And I don't really know how to describe it besides that, but it's something you can play around with and see what you like the best. And I've been using this since about last November. And so I know what my formats are, what I like, what I don't like, and I process them, try to process them very similarly so I can compare from machine to machine what I'm doing. So here's your four motions. You can also apply color contour, and we'll see it go in a second here. So this is at pump speed. So I got a different motion in the platform, more of a vertical response in the motor as it flexes that platform. The color contour shows you how it's all in phase. You can see that the line of color here. There's my orbit plot. Like I had before for motor speed, this is for pump speed. And my vector plot. So here they're a little out of phase. So I get some alternating motion every revolution of the shaft. That's a little bit different. So interesting, everything's every frequency has its own characteristics, its own motion. This is motor speed, so same thing. So we've seen the orbit and the vector plot. Here's the color contour plot, normal exposure, and so forth. So you get some nice stuff out of this, and it makes everything come to life. I tell all my classes, I've been a vibration analyst for 30 years. There's nothing I've seen in the industry that gives you more insight to motion. And it's not just the videos, it's operating deflection shape, experimental modal analysis, all these things you can do and animate. You know, if I'm sitting in front of people in a conference room and I'm just talking from a sheet of paper, I'll put the room to sleep. But if I put an animation up on the screen, everyone's engaged, especially this. And that's exactly what happened with this job. It's flexing. They know what frequency it's flexing at. They can see the distortion. The whole room has ideas about how to fix that. It's really something else. All right, so that was number 10, which probably should have been number one, but I wanted to get the little tutorial with the wizard out of the way so you can see what we're doing. This is number 9. So this was something I did a couple of weeks ago. We were looking at coupling problems, and this was a manufacturer that built compressors, and it wasn't a compressor problem, it was a coupling problem. So the shim pack couplings, this unit is on a variable frequency drive, and there's some speed that was exciting a torsional vibration that was failing the couplings. So these little shim packs in here were breaking and fatiguing way before they should have. You should get years and years and years of operation out of these things without any problems at all. But in this case, you have a torsional problem. It's not like your normal vibration problem. It's a twisting of the rotating shaft, and that goes into resonance. So very interesting process. The only way we could look at this was with a video. There's no virtually no other way to do it. You can't put a transducer on this thing because it's rotating. You can't get near most of them because they have the coupling guard on and they won't take it off because of safety reasons. So if this one was a controlled system in a plant, we could vary the speed, we could take the cover off, and you know, as long as we're careful, we're not going to cause any problems. This is a little confusing all at once. There's a lot going on. Give me a moment to tell you how this works. So each row is different. The top row is the unfiltered time waveform. This guy, we have 1 times RPM, and this is a frequency domain plot. We can animate in the time waveform or the frequency domain. This is 2 different frequencies that we're interested in: turning speed of the shaft and 6 times turning speed, which is the blade pass frequency, or in this case, there's a scroll inside the compressor that puts out a pulsation, and there's 6 turns on that scroll. Down at the bottom, everything's in the time domain. Okay, I have the unfiltered time waveform. I have filtered 1 times RPM out of the complex time waveform and animated only that. So this is turning speed. And I have filtered also at 6 times turning speed. Okay, so up here, here's just regular motion that we can slow it down and look at it and see frame per frame, you know, what's going on. This is a little more interesting. This shows, if you look, this bolt and that bolt, they're kind of in phase, and there's mostly some kind of axial motion here, which is kind of interesting. So this is normal misalignment, I would say, in the coupling. This, at 6 times running speed, there is no axial motion. It's more of a twisting motion. Kind of hard to see in one view, but that's what we're seeing here. We're seeing this kind of a radial motion going on. This is the torsional pulsation that's coming from 6 times running speed from the blade passing, basically. Down at the bottom here, unfiltered, so these two look identical, which they are, but when I filter the 1 times RPM out of the complex time waveform, I get my 1 times RPM and I get it as a rotation. Here in the frequency domain or the FFT, you don't see the shaft motion rotation. Here you do. So it's a time waveform. I explained this the last class real quick. You take the FFT of the time waveform, you filter out the frequency you want, you have a bandpass filter, and then you inverse FFT, go back to the time domain, and this is what you get. Now take a look at this, and you watch it long enough, there's a little bit of an axial flow to this. Here I could isolate it as a min-max type thing at any position of the shaft. Here, as it rotates, it's kind of a thrust looking animation, which it normally is. This is how couplings look when they're misaligned slightly. Okay, so it's either an angular offset or a radial offset. Over here at the 6 times pulsation, did the same thing. I filtered out the blade pass frequency, basically. There's no axial galloping like we're seeing here. Okay, this is all torsional, and still hard to see how much torsion's in there. We did some little tricks in the software to try to pull that out. We could tell that there was some torsion across this. It wasn't a problem because we weren't sitting right on that torsional frequency, the torsional natural frequency. Then it really takes off, and you really don't want to sit there that long. But we are in the process of finding that. So we've just calculated out what it is, and we're going to take a little deeper look into it. What else do you get? Well, it's the MEscope software. You can do an ODS. I did a 28 locations. I did on the motor feet, motor housing, on the compressor feet and some of its input side and output side flanges, and just to get a rough look at the motion. So this is turning speed of the motor, 3588, and you can see the couplings misaligned. So I have basically two sets of data, one on either side of the coupling. Now I have, set all the data on this coupling hub, which is spinning, right? So I didn't take data directly on it. I matched that, interpolated it based on the motor. I took this side and I interpolated this hub for the compressor, but I didn't do anything for the spool piece. So the spool piece is doing what it wants to do. So what it looks like here is there's a misalignment in this shimpack section. Okay. These two, the hub and the spool on this side, seem to be locked in. And of course it's exaggerated so that you can see the motion, but that is physically what it's doing. Okay. Another nice thing about the operating deflection shapes software is that you can turn it different directions. So this is a pure side view. We ended up finding out that there was a loose foot here on this part of the inboard compressor foot that we had to tighten up. There's a little bit of twist in the frame supporting the motor. Okay, but everything was pretty low in the 0.1. I think the highest thing we got was about 0.13 inches per second. And one other view, you can see the coupling changing. So these are all at running speed, turning speed of the motor, 3588, and they're all the same animation, different directions. When you're doing video animation, it's really hard to get a good single shot that will show you anything like this. So remember, you buy the camera, you buy the ODS video software, you have ODS signal processing included. So now you can do this as well. So you can do a deeper dive. And even deeper, you can do modal analysis. Like I mentioned earlier, you can't curve fit the data with just the ODS Pro software that comes with the ODS videos, but you can animate a peak in any data set. And this was a likely natural frequency at 3105 CPM. And you can see how it makes the structure move. Okay. And in this case, it was a modal test. The machine was off. I took data on each of the shimpack hubs. So I could actually see what the compressor was there, the coupling was actually doing as it ran. So it does show a little bit of misalignment. And interesting, because I've never seen misalignment like this in a modal test. But anyway, we can talk about that later. We have to move on. So this was number 9. We're going to go to number 8. Number 8 was a knocking sound from a pulp press in a sugar processing plant in Minnesota. This gearbox was extremely low speed. And I show an image of the gearbox. The input speed was like 215 RPM. The output speed was 1.2 RPM, something like that. Very, very slow. But for video, it's fantastic. The only bad thing is there was a port that I was looking through here, rectangular port, and you can't get enough light in there sometimes to see all the gears and things like that. So I was shooting through a port going through here. I could see this gear and part of this gear, I think. Whoop. Sorry. Anyway, it made some really interesting animations, one of which is this guy. And it's hard to make out exactly what's going on, but there was some binding in the gearbox. There was a knocking sound, a real hollow ring, because it's a massive gearbox. And you can see the teeth deforming slightly. So they're ringing. And it's, some might say, well, maybe it's the lubrication dripping off of it, but no, they're pinging in different locations as you get that binding or that gear meshing. So this was at 1x the fourth gear mesh, and there's a lot of reductions here. So we have a drive speed, three intermediate speeds, and an output speed. Okay, and we have four gear meshes. So multiples of 91.5, which are right here. So all the 1x gear mesh four, 2x gear mesh, 3x, we can animate anything. Which brings me to my point. There's more than just the video. So you don't just put your cursor on whatever frequency you want to investigate. You can also do signal processing analysis. So there's two sets of gear meshes here. This is gear mesh, 1x gear mesh number three. So the blue circles are one of the gear meshes and the red circles are another. And this is all extracted information out of the video picture. Okay, it's amazing how much signal processing power you have. I put this in a log scale so you could actually see it, and there's a lot to it. So the third and fourth gear mesh frequency are the ones that I can visually see that are introducing all this energy. The other thing you can look at, and we know from just basic vibration analysis, that if you have a broken tooth in a gearbox, you're not going to see it in the frequency spectrum, but you will see that pulse in the time waveform. And usually it excites the structure every time that broken tooth goes into mesh. What you're going to see here, though, this is a little bit different. This is such a sharp peak. It's, if in a real life, in a perfect world, this would be a sine wave, not a skewed pointy peak like that. It would be a perfect meshing type sine wave. This is telling me that there's some binding that releases quickly, especially this slanted some kind of sawtooth looking pattern. Something is binding the gears slightly and they're letting go. And that supports what I'm seeing. I'm seeing this pulse, boom, boom, boom. Not, there's multiple gear meshings in this system, so you see a lot of stuff. How bad is it? Well, we can define if we have a broken tooth. I think this is just a binding signature. We can define if we have changes in the spectrum over time, so we can take multiple video images and look at them. And we can look at the video itself. What I propose for this, I haven't done it yet, is they have three other gearboxes that are identical, and I want to shoot the same video in each one and compare all the data and see, get a baseline, see what a good unit versus a bad unit produce. So there's a lot you can get from just the signal processing parameters in the ODS video software. Okay, this is that little port I was talking about. So another angle, so I could pick out this gear mesh. So this is the fourth gear mesh frequency. And it's standing still because I'm animating this in the frequency domain. If I look down here at the bottom, I see four different motions, but they look very similar. When I look at it with color contour on the top, I can tell they're completely different deformations of the gear teeth. So these could be the teeth going into a natural frequency, or the hub, or both. So there's a lot of motion in here that is unexplored. If I go to the other three gearboxes and I do this exact same animation, it gives me a lot of information if these don't look the same. If there's something else going on in this box due to that binding effect that doesn't go on in any of the others, then it's giving me basically a criteria for what's good and what's bad. Okay, got to move a little faster. We got about 15 minutes left. This is number 7 in our top 10. This was a belt-driven fan. I had two frequencies of interest. I had it at 1422, I think. No, 2214, I think, 2277, which is the speed of the fan. This is a speed increaser belt drive. And this was 1800 RPMs, I believe. But we'll get to that in a second. If you do have the hardware, software, what have you, and you start doing the videos, take a picture of your setup I tell people to do this all the time. Before you start your animations and stuff, set it all up, take a picture with your cell phone, okay? It helps you remember things that are happening, helps you document what was going on at the time you took the image, okay? And I'm a doctor that should take its own medicine because I many times forget to do this. Put it on your checklist. This is interesting. This is the first image I got, was an end view of the motor. And I'm like, God, it's twisting. But really what's happening is it's sitting on a framework that's twisting. So flexing or pitching or what have you. And the motor itself is a little out of phase. So there's something going on in this frame that's supporting this motor. So motor at 2277 RPM, this is fan speed. So there's something wrong with the fan side of the motor that's driving the whole platform. Okay, this is the motor at 2277, which is 1x fan speed again. So a side view of this image, and you can see how it's twisting and flexing. This is actual motor speed, 1791, okay? And it's bouncing vertically. So it has a different shape of motion, different operating shape. So these are all occurring at the same time. I'm bouncing due to the rotational effects of the motor, and I'm pitching and twisting due to the fan speed. And the likely thing that's going on is there's a resonant in the support frame underneath these. This is number six. This is in a cement plant. And I was working a different job and I had some time to walk around a little bit because I was waiting about an hour for some gearbox to process. And I found this motor and I put my hand on it. And I'm like, wow, it's shaking pretty good. And I thought this could be a little looseness problem, what have you. So I took some images of it. This is the motor. It's 1198 RPM, and the whole thing's bouncing and twisting a little bit, and even the coupling guard's going for a ride. And I looked at the feet, and I'm thinking, well, you know, all this dust is cement dust. I'm going to clean this off and see if see how it's really moving. Here's the color contour plot. So everything seems to be, you know, in phase or have a motion across the whole structure, but had to make sure. So I'm thinking this motor foot looks a little loose. So I cleaned off all the cement dust and the crack. There's no relative motion at all in that crack. Okay. And it's all moving together with its whatever it's mounted to here. There's a plate and it's grouted in, and I'm not sure what's underneath it. There's about 6 inches of dust everywhere. But it's not a looseness problem. It's more of a foundation issue underneath the entire machine, which kind of surprised me. I didn't expect that when I went up and started looking at it. You see a lot of surprising things that, like this. This is a cement plant, a ball mill gearbox. A ball mill is a giant cylinder that has softball size steel balls in it, and they put rock in there that's crushed into dust, and that's part of the cement making process. This was on the side of that gearbox, and this was one of the gears inside, one of the intermediate speed gears that I took a look at, and it's bouncing. It's engaged with another gear, but it's got a lot of vertical bounce to it, and so much so that the lubrication, this brown stuff, is coming off the gears. If you look at it real time, it's the lubrication's like a shower coming down. And I didn't think the image was going to be any good, and it's actually turned out to be one of the best images of a gear I've had. But very interesting. So we can process this. Here's my normal exposure. It's 3416, which is the gear mesh frequency for this gear. And it's definitely bouncing at gear mesh frequency. So the engagement between the two gears, probably a little misalignment, something's going little more flexible than I would expect any of the other gearboxes to be doing. I did a color contour just to see if I could pick out anything else. And actually I like the regular exposure better. this is in the frequency domain. So at that frequency, it doesn't show the rotational effects like the time waveform versions, but it does show kind of a gear mode, maybe a natural frequency of the gear. And it doesn't show the bouncing like the time waveform does. So maybe it has a natural frequency that's a little close to 3416 and is exciting that. Okay, but it's interesting. So up here, ball mill shows a bouncing motion at gear mesh frequency. Meshing color contour animation in the time domain shows the bouncing response as well as the rotation of the gears. Color contour in the frequency domain eliminates the rotational motion from the animation. This is number four, belt-driven fan system. And my customer wanted me to take a look at the base here, the sliding base underneath and the C-channel structure. The motor itself, they were having problems getting this thing aligned and set up. They were failing bearings on the fan side of the pulley system. So they needed a little idea of, is this bouncing? What's going on inside here? Okay, so the video is a perfect look at that. In fact, this is a frame from the first video I took, and it didn't show me anything conclusive. It was a really poor animation. I was kind of surprised with it. It made a little more sense the more I dug, but I decided to move over and do a close-up of that. Let me go back a page. Do close up from this angle of that sliding base structure so I could see what's going on. A couple things to notice, you know, this is like any sliding base. You do it to apply tension to the belts so that everything's uniform and everything's aligned. The C channel, there's no bolts. Okay, so this is free on this end, but this C channel, the C channel on the other side, there's no bolts in there, which is fine if you grout stuff in, but usually there's, even then there's bolts that hold it down. So I'm seeing a little bit of a gap here. Might be just a shadow or what have you. This looked like a decent animation. Something's going on. The motor appears to be moving vertically, and the animation with the color contour isn't what I expected. I expected it to be uniform and having, you know, linear motion, and it's really not. So the levels weren't very high, and the motion didn't look in phase at all. Now, contrasting, we went around the end bell side of the motor, which you can see here, and shot through, and we were looking for how the feet are mounted. And the whole platform, the foot, everything's bolted together tight. Here's the shell on top of the C channel. And everything's moving, even the C channel. So there, if that tells me that there's not enough adhesion, if any, holding this thing down. And there might be something that I can't see in between the plates or what have you, but it all looks like it's a frame that might have been grouted in at one time, but I don't think it is now. The color contour here, this is what I was expecting for the overall view on the outside, was something that looked like this. And you can see how everything's moving in phase. There's kind of a orbital motion to it. This would have been a good candidate for an orbit plot. But it doesn't look like it's loose. It looks like it's got a joint that isn't correct. And so it is loose, but not between the bolted connections, between the grouted connections. This was the third view I took, and it's on this side, on the inner side underneath the belt. So I shot through there, and everything here is all together as well. The motor connection box on the side is wagon, but the takeaway here is everything is moving in phase. And here's that C channel that it's mounted to, and there's a whole pile of dirt and debris down here, so I can't see if there's bolts or not. But the inboard side there's something going on. There's some type of looseness, either a broken grout line or doesn't look like any mechanical fastener that's failed, but it's definitely something's going on. So we're fighting this to try to figure out how to fix it. so that we quit feeling bearings on the other side on the fan shaft. This is number three, and this is not a nuisance at all. It just intrigued me. I was waiting for a machine to start up so I could do some video on it. And right next to where I was, there was this pump, and it was a direct driven pump, and it was all in a skid and supported by isolators all the way around. So it sat about 12 inches off the ground. And the reason this design was made is all the pumps in that area had the same design, and they thought it was practical, but they started removing them in the last couple of years because the skids, the whole structure moved so much with the isolators in there that they were putting loads into the piping, and they started to fail piping. So they started walking away from this type of design. Okay. This is the motor. So when I put my hand on it, I said, whoa, that's really going. Okay. You can see the fan spinning on the inside. So this is time waveform animation at 297 CPM. So not the turning speed of the motor, it's the isolator frequency. Okay. That isolator frequency is, you know, when you get close to 297, it's an amplifier and you'll get a lot of motion, but it is creating an isolation effect at higher frequencies for this structure. So the energy is kept within the skid and doesn't get out to the rest of the building. But everything's in phase as you would expect. There's no relative motion in the mounts. This is the kind of the cool video that I was working on. So the whole skid is supported on these six isolator mounts, and they're doing a little dance. And surprisingly, it's a little lateral motion. And that's the dominant response. But it is what it is. So it's nothing really wrong, but interesting motion. Number two, direct driven pump and piping system investigation. It was an apparent resonance in the piping. This pump had a lot of vibration. I'll show you the animation, but remember what I said. This is the setup picture. So I took a picture of the setup. Okay, remember to do that when you're doing this. It really helps when you can't remember what you actually did. So this discharge line, it goes up. There's a isolation joint here. There's a valve there. It goes into a pipe. There's another motor right across from it. Only one runs at a time usually, but there's the discharge line goes this way. So this line goes about 60 feet, maybe 100 feet. Out from this juncture up here, okay? This is the machine. So this is the first animation I took, and I was, holy cow, this thing's moving. Amazing. And what I was thinking was it's way too high. It was an inch per second here. Way too high for just a misalignment. That can't be causing. Up here, the piping goes way up, and then it ties together and goes across. The idea was, hey, this is probably a natural frequency that's driving through the piping and shaking the whole structure. This is a view from the other side of the machine. So I got one from this end, and I got a kind of a three-dimensional one here, and you can see how it's flexing. So I was checking. It doesn't look like there's any relative motion across that joint. Doesn't really look like there's any of that here either. Just it's bending as it's going. Okay. So I asked the customer if I could come back in and do a modal test. So I have the software, I can do modal analysis, I can do operating deflection shape, what have you. This is one of the first images I got. This is the frequency spectrum. So there's a lot of natural frequencies. Sorry, got my cursor up in there. Well, there we go. Okay, sorry, my cursor was lighting up that thing. There's a peak on the lower end, and it's 3046 written up here, and there's a peak at 4130, and they're basically a valley between them. So there's no, and these are 15% speed margin apart. So there's no frequency right down in the middle of these. So my assumption that there's a natural frequency of the piping that's driving this was incorrect. But one thing I did prove was this is the mode. It is going into a third bending mode. This is about 60, I think it was 60 feet long, something like that. So you are twisting this housing. You are getting some response into here, but not the same mode shape here. Okay, if you remember that previous mode shape, it's pitching. This guy. Okay, I'm not driving that motion at all at 3150 or 3046. That's what this was. But I do get a nice mode shape, okay, because there is a natural frequency there. But is it caused by that? Nope, not at all. Looked at the other one. This is at 4130. The shape of the motion in the video is not like that. And this is at 4130. It has 15% margin on this 3600 RPM operating speed. So there's nothing else that's exciting this piping. So is that a problem? No. This 3046 and 4130, they're fat, dumb, and happy. They're just natural frequencies. They're not resonance conditions. A resonance is when you excite a natural frequency. Here, they're too far away from an excitation source, which is the motor speed, to be excited. Okay, so we proved it's not a natural frequency problem. The thing we're working on now is maybe it is a foundation problem right here. They did dig out the foundation. They should have the right conditions here that it's not loose, but they're going to check that. And if it's still going into this shape, we're going to put a gusset in here, triangular gusset, sideways in the axial direction of a shaft to restrict the motion in the foundation. Just get a better three-point contact on here. So on this side, we'll bring a flange in. And that should make the problem go away and give us enough stiffness in there. Okay, and last but not least, who could leave out wind turbines? This investigation was conducted to determine a tower natural frequency. So what's all the other different, you know, blade pass frequencies and the different pulsations and so forth were not the main concern, but you know, you take a lot of video, you get all kinds of different things that come out of it. So I zoomed in on the tower and we did a shutdown transient. And I'll say that this is a very low frequency, okay? And what we were trying to do was determine if that natural frequency was too close to turning speed of the turbine. And if it was, and you excite the tower like this, you start breaking bolts in the tower and, you know, potentially knock down a turbine. I ended up in this case having to take the entire buffer of the camera. So 8-second buffer was about a cycle and a half of turning speed. Okay. It only turns at 14.9 RPM, something like that. Okay, what does this show me? The shutdown transient. We were running full speed. We commanded a shutdown. What it does is it turns the blades into the wind. And so it removes the force. So basically you're running and the wind forces are forcing the tower in this case, in the axial direction, and you run that way. And when you turn the blades into the wind, you remove that force and it rings the tower. This motion is plus or minus maybe a foot. So it's a good motion, and it's got a little bit of sideway motion as well. So you're going to have two natural frequencies, one in this case in the prop direction and the one in the cross axis. And we excited a little bit of both when we did the shutdown. Okay. But we, in this case, we proved that we didn't have a problem with turning speed. There was a balance guy that balances wind turbines all over the place, and he was afraid to go in one of these towers because of how much vibration he was sensing. So it turned out to be probably a different problem with the balance guy, but we were checking it out. So very interesting problem. There's a couple other animations, same unit. This is the rotating speed, so 14.9 RPM. and it's in the frequency domain, so I can see a still image basically of the blade. So this was while it was running, and I can see the deformation in the blades. And actually, this one was exciting the tower, which is kind of interesting. So if I put a cursor here, you can see how much motion that was. That's probably six, seven inches, something like that. This was a still image. It was rotating. It's in the frequency domain. This is blade pass frequency. So every time a blade passes the tower, you get a pulsation, just like any fan or pump or what have you. But it's that space between the blade and the tower that compresses the air, and it ends up exciting the blade modes. And you try to keep the blade modes away from that pulsation, and this is what was there. So kind of interesting. Okay, little tower motion, little blade motion, very little tower motion. All right, that's the top 10. Very exciting. We do have some training and some packages that we can talk about if you guys are interested. The entire thing from scratch gives you VT420, which is the ODS Pro software. It's all the signal processing data analysis and the video processing, $13,595. You still have to buy a camera, and there's a couple different camera packages that include all the lights. They include the tripods, and of course the camera. So we are using the Kronos cameras from Kron Technology. They have the 1.4 version. They just came out with the 2.1 version. So a little bit of different variations in them. And obviously the newer stuff's kind of nice and slick, but they both work fantastic. They're both in either color or monochrome. If you already have visual ODS, just the basic ODS package, you have to purchase just the ODS video processing. So $9,000 for that, and you are in a much better deal. So it's about $4,000 less than the overall package. Okay. And great stuff. Roller bag with all your equipment you're going to need. So there's lights, there's tripods, there's all kinds of things like that. Makes it handy carrying all the stuff. What else do we have? We have also offered, we have a on-site or webinar version of training, MEscope ODS videos training. We have camera setup, lighting logistics, the wizard, hotkeys, there's workbook examples. So everything I've shown you here can be reprocessed if you have the raw video files, and there's a lot to learn. So if you're interested in that, we offer it. We can get you some pricing on it. Usually we try to go to you. It's always better to solve your own problems than to sit in a classroom in a hotel somewhere. So if you're up for it, if the COVID stuff is kind of passing in your plant and you're getting people back in for training, that's the time to do it. And then we can go out and do one or two of your machines and process that data, and you guys can solve problems while you're training. That's all I got. Mark, you still there?
I'm still here. Yeah. All right. We got a question. If you have any questions, again, please type your questions into the dialogue box there, and we'll get your questions answered. First question in from Nick is, he's asking, how are you able to filter out camera and mount vibration in the video image?
Well, there's a couple things. There's a on-off switch on a BNC cable that comes out of the side of the camera. There's a lot of little trigger devices and things like that that are high end. This is the easiest one. This is just a push button. You can start or stop the camera remotely. So when it's on its tripod and you actually press the record button, you put a little pulse into the camera, and it's there. No matter how lightly you touch it, you're going to see it in your data. The way to get around that is to take more than 8 seconds worth of data. So it's in a buffer. It'll re-record over it. So it only records 8 seconds. So that ninth second is eliminating second number one, and the 10th second is second number two, and so forth. And it keeps going that way. So basically what I do is I use that push button, and to be safe, I record 16 or 20 seconds worth of data. Okay, I'm only going to get 8, but I'm eliminating that touching pulse that I put into the camera. The other thing you can do in the software is there's that histogram tool that we can look at high amplitude, low frequency events, or low amplitude, high frequency events. So I don't know if I've defined that quite right, but it gets rid of the background noise that you're not interested in. And if you can't do it automatically with those features, remember this thing is all to a grid. So you can go into the software and you can turn off the grid points you're not interested in. And there's a, you know, you don't have to click on them one at a time. There's a group collect and things like that. So I've done that in some cases where I had a guy with a flashlight walking behind the machine and the light was flicking around, and it was a huge vibration as far as, you know, the camera thought. But I could go in there and put a block of, just turn off all those grid points, and it worked fine. Fantastic. But, you know, there's upfront stuff. The switch really helps. The over recording in the buffer, and then, you know, there are software tools like that that can help you get rid of the stubborn stuff.
All right. Another question from, we got a question from Kristen. How can I get a quote for training? Kristen, you can email us at sales@vibetech.com. You can also email Dan directly at modalguy@aol.com if you want to get some numbers back on training. They are kind of more of a custom quote depending on what you're looking for. Second question from Kristen: I purchased an aftermarket push button trigger and I wasn't able to get the camera to start using it.
You have to upgrade the software. If you had a camera that's the 1.4 Cronus camera, actually probably both of them, but they came out with a software upgrade that you could start and stop with that trigger. And All you do is go to their site and download it. Basically, the camera is a computer. So you just,
yeah, so it's like any firmware.
Yeah, so it'll download the new firmware and everything will be great.
Great, so give that a try, Chris, and see if that works for you. Let's see here if we got any more questions. That is it right now. Ramiro says, thanks, I need to leave for another meeting. All right, Ramiro, well, glad you could join us. If you got some questions, after you get off the webinar here, you can always email us at sales@vibetech.com and we can answer those questions offline. Again, this webinar is being recorded, so you will get a link in your email inbox with a link to the recording, a full recording of this webinar. And then we'll also post it out on our website so you can go back and review it from there. Let's see here if there's anything else. I think that's it right now, Dan.
All right. Well, thank you, everybody. Appreciate it. Hope to hear from you.
Appreciate it. Absolutely. And stay tuned. We'll get another one of these webinars going here in a couple weeks. And we hope to see everybody soon. Stay safe, everyone, and take care of yourself.